We planned this event actually back in March 2020. That was the time we did the renaming of our school. So it was the School for Conflict and Asset Resolution, and we had the opportunity to rename the school as the Carter School for Peace and Conflict Resolution. But as you remember what happened then, the pandemic arrived and the life kind of changed and stalled. We couldn't do the kind of celebration part. And so when we had the opportunity after the pandemic, our team was thinking about, you know, what can we do to celebrate the legacy and impact of the Carters, who've been so busy over the last 40 years in so many areas? I mean, obviously, right now, until now, we've been talking about their work in conflict resolution, but they've been working in health, in human rights, election monitoring, and development in all different areas. And for me, that is probably the most important and the kind of like the impressive part of their work. The intersectionality of their work, the way they connect all these different areas. And earlier on, Rich was talking about peace building. That is peace building, you know, being able to find those connections so that in a conflict resolution, peacemaking is sustainable and the peace that we create can live much longer. So with that note, the next speaker is from the Carter Center. And the Carter Center, I must say, has been such a wonderful support for us here at the Carter School. And since our renaming, we work with them on different occasions and we hosted them at our different events. And I really appreciate that, being able to share the name Carter, the center, and the Carter School for Peace and Conflict Resolution is a great privilege. But obviously, our goal is to be able to work together in our own ways to make those connections. So our next speaker is Barbara Smith. She's currently overseeing the Carter Center's Global Democracy and Human Rights Initiatives, and she brings a wealth of international experience. Prior to joining the Carter Center in 2020, she founded Mountain Time Development, contributed to the Center for Strategic and International Studies Human Rights Initiative, and held numerous roles at USID, notably shaping its 2013 Democracy, Human Rights, and Governance Strategy. Barbara Smith's distinguished service record includes position on the National Security Council, the Asia Foundation, and UN roles in Bosnia-Herzegovina and Afghanistan. She holds degrees from the University of Texas and Texas State University, and she's joined here with a couple of other colleagues, Stacey George, and she's the director of the Conflict Resolution Program at the Carter Center, and also Dr. Carol Kaspari. And I'm really proud of Carol because she's a graduate of the Carter School, and now she works at the Carter Center. And these are natural links with the Carter Center, and I'm so pleased to welcome all of you here. And this presentation by Barbara is really to present that spectrum, wide spectrum of the Carter Center and all they do. And rightly so, the presentation is entitled Waging Peace, Fighting Disease, Building Hope. Barbara.
So thank you so much. That was such a nice, warm welcome for me and my team here. And thank you so much for organizing this event. I remember us sitting and having coffee, I think it was over a year ago, just kind of talking about this. And so it's great to see this come to fruition. So a little bit more about myself. So I actually joined the Carter Center quite recently, given its 40-year history. I joined about 3 years ago. But President Carter has actually been a hero of mine for pretty much my entire life, as long as I can remember. When I was a young girl, I remember my mom talking about President Carter's fireside chats, and she would talk about the need that we should conserve energy at home. And I remember talking about his work on peace and human rights. And I think it was really those early stories that really kind of got me into this line of work. You know, they stoked my interest in the environment and in human rights. And although I ultimately didn't become an environmentalist, I did go into public service and into peace building. And so they sowed a seed in me that grew into that energy and enthusiasm for peace building. So I did end up spending about 14 years in public service working at the U.S. Agency for International Development, as well as the National Security Council, worked at the U.N., I worked for nonprofits in Asia and Europe, and then eventually my path led me back to the Carter Center. So 3 years ago, I got the call, and I was thrilled and honored to join the Carter Center in its mission to wage peace, fight disease, and build hope. But understanding, as I was learning about the President Carter and the Carter Center's recent history, I was also a little intimidated by the weight of it all and everything that's been achieved. And I'm so pleased to be able to share that with you today. As we honor the Carters, I also want to acknowledge one of their most recent courageous acts. And that was to share publicly and honestly about their own health struggles. Their actions offer us one more lesson in dignity and grace. Today, they're exactly where they want to be, together in Plains, Georgia. Their fervent wish, though, is that the causes that they believe in will find even more champions to ensure health, human rights, and peace for people everywhere. So with that in mind, I want to share with you how President and Mrs. Carter have sown seeds of peace around the world, seeds that have grown into things like the Carter Center, but also the Jimmy and Rosalynn Carter School for Peace and Conflict Resolution. So I'm going to step back a little, and then I'll share with you a little bit more about the Carter Center. So President Carter first started thinking about justice and injustice, human suffering, as a child in segregated Plains, Georgia. Despite the social mores of that time and place, he developed lasting friendships with Black children and adults, and he noted later in life that, quote, "I grew up in the segregated South and saw the ravages of racial discrimination and the violation of human rights." Those experiences helped shape President Carter's worldview and led him to become a strong advocate for integration and equal rights. As we heard from our last speaker, President Carter graduated from the Naval Academy and served and after his military service, returned home to Plains. And in 1962, he entered state politics, and 8 years later, he was elected governor of Georgia. Governor Carter emphasized environmental protection, efficiency in government, which he still emphasizes today, efficiency in all things we do, and removal of racial barriers. In his gubernatorial inaugural address, he said, quote, "Time for racial discrimination is over. No poor, rural, weak, or Black person should ever have to bear the additional burden of being deprived of the opportunity of an education, of a job, or simply justice." President Carter maintained his moral stance on integration throughout his term as governor. The number of Black appointees on Georgia's state boards and agencies rose from 3 to 53 during his time in office, and he increased the overall number of Black state employees by 25%. Carter then announced his candidacy for president in December of 1974. His focus on human rights and justice solidified while he was on the campaign trail. Many Americans expressed in their concerns about the Vietnam War, as well as the need for a stable home, food, and health care, and a life free from fear and persecution. And as president, Carter improved human and social services, created the Department of Education, and bolstered Social Security. He also appointed a record number of women and people of color to government positions. And in foreign affairs, President Carter had the difficult task of managing Cold War tensions while being a champion for human rights. He navigated a nuclear arms reduction treaty with the Soviet Union while also speaking out against human rights violations in the Soviet Union and in the Middle East. Through the Camp David Accords of 1978, President Carter helped bring peace between Egypt and Israel. Later in his life, he dedicated himself and the Carter Center, where we work, to the pursuit of freedom and self-determination for the Palestinian people, which he calls the unfinished business of the Camp David summit. This work is particularly important in light of tragic events in the region. Despite strong opposition in Congress, President Carter also succeeded in obtaining ratification of the Panama Canal treaties, as we know. He also threatened to cut off military aid to authoritarian Latin American allies like Argentina if they persisted with human rights abuses. This move bolstered democratic movements across the region. And building on the work of predecessors, President Carter established full diplomatic relations with the People's Republic of China, while at the same time pressuring Beijing to allow a measure of religious freedom, student exchanges, and political prisoner releases. These efforts were framed by important policy developments. In 1978, President Carter's administration formally defined U.S. policy on human rights in a now famous presidential directive. It stated that one of the objectives of U.S. foreign policy should be the observance of global human rights. To implement this directive, the administration also elevated the position of coordinator for human rights and humanitarian affairs in the State Department to what is now known today as the Bureau for Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor. Carter's presidency was not easy, though. There were some serious setbacks. The Soviet invasion of Afghanistan derailed ratification of a second nuclear arms reduction treaty, and the seizure of the U.S. embassy in Iran and the resulting hostage crisis dominated the news during the last 14 months of his administration. And the consequences of Iran's holding Americans captive, together with the continuing economic challenges at home, contributed to Carter's re-election defeat in 1980. So after leaving office, President Carter didn't take long to resume his vision, sort of pushing that vision that I've sort of set the stage for. He also wrote, as we know, prolifically about human rights issues, including books on topics such as Palestine, and women's rights. But he also wrote children's books. He wrote books about his life, his time in the White House. It is incredibly impressive, the number of books and the knowledge that he has shared with us. Upon returning to Georgia, he also had the idea of creating what he called a miniature Camp David, where he could bring adversaries together to address their conflicts. The Carters wanted to create a place for people from all walks of life and all religious and ethnic backgrounds to come together to seek peaceful resolutions to troubling and complicated challenges. Out of this dream, the place where I now work, where Stacia works, where we work together, is the Carter Center, was born. In developing the center's mission, President and Mrs. Carter aimed to sow the seeds of peace. I like this quote and how it summarizes this. At the Carter Center, we believe all people are entitled to basic human rights. When people have these rights, they feel a sense of justice and self-worth. These are the seeds of peace. The Carter Center was founded on the principle that everyone on earth should be able to live in peace. In pursuit of this goal, the center has earned an international reputation for bringing people and resources together to resolve conflict, foster democracy and development, and fight disease and human rights abuses. So I'd like to pause now to share a short video that helps kind of illustrate the ethos of the Carter Center. So if we can start with the first video.
There are more than 7 billion faces on Earth, some full of hope and dreams. Others empty with despair, constrained by barriers that keep them from healthy and productive lives. The Carter Center works to tear down those barriers and create a world where everyone has a chance to live in peace and enjoy basic human rights.
We are willing to take a chance that we might fail if we believe that the ultimate goal is worthwhile, worth our effort, and worth an investment in people who have been neglected by others.
She gets three tablets.
The Carter Center has worked in over 80 countries to advance peace and fight devastating diseases.
Salam alaikum.
Over the years, the center has helped improve relations among nations and has worked to promote human rights, resolve conflicts, and strengthen democracies.
Did you vote?
Yes.
Congratulations.
The center has observed more than 100 elections in countries in Asia, Africa, and the Americas. As a result, leaders are held accountable to the people in places that have never had free and fair elections. The Carter Center is a leader in fighting neglected diseases, diseases like guinea worm, river blindness, trachoma, and lymphatic filariasis. These are gone from the developed world, but they still afflict some of the poorest people on Earth.
These diseases are all preventable. If the folks are just given a chance to know what they can do to improve their own lives, then they can transform their own lives into an opportunity for hope and self-respect and anticipation of a better future.
The center also strives to improve access to mental health care and reduce stigma and discrimination against those with mental illnesses.
So today is the last day that you will distribute here.
The people of the Carter Center work for peace, fight disease, and most importantly, bring hope to those who never had it before.
We were the poorest, most isolated people in the world. And often, if we weren't there, there would be nobody to help them.
The Carter Center works where the need is greatest, to improve the lives of the poor, the disadvantaged, and those who have no voice.
I love hearing the Carters themselves talk about their work, and so it's always nice to share these videos and to hear directly from our founders. So how exactly are we advancing that mission and sowing those seeds of peace that I talked about? Our work is, broken down into kind of four different program areas. We work on rule of law or justice, human rights, conflict resolution, and democracy, which is where and houses sort of some of our more well-known programs around election observation. Now, I would like to kind of share a few stories from our early work involving President Carter and then talk a little bit about what we're doing today around the world. I'm going to start with one story some of you may have heard about, the Sudan guinea worm ceasefire. So I think it's a great example of how President Carter and the Carter Center have used our resources and expertise for tangible results to improve people's lives. So let's take ourselves back to the early 1990s. A civil war is raging in Sudan. And this meant at the time that public health workers, including Carter Center personnel, couldn't access areas where the painful parasitic disease, guinea worm, was ravaging the population. In 1995, President Carter negotiated with the warring parties for an initial 4-month-long guinea worm ceasefire, convincing both sides that this ceasefire was for a worthy humanitarian cause and that neither army would gain an advantage as a result of this. The truce actually lasted for 6 months, and that made it the longest humanitarian ceasefire in history. This guinea worm ceasefire allowed health workers to access some 2,000 endemic villages and distribute over 200,000 cloth filters to strain the parasitic larvae out of the drinking water, preventing new infections. Sudan has actually been certified free of guinea worm since 2002, and the Republic of South Sudan, which gained independence in 2011, reported only 5 human cases in 2022, among just 13 worldwide. So I'd like to take this opportunity to show one more video that highlights what it took to get the guinea worm numbers down to where they are today. So let's roll the second video. Thanks.
my, how far today we've come. Through war, through gore, through all that's glum. Through the crippling chorus of the doubters' drums that banged on loud that it can't be done. 3,500,000 was the starting sum, whilst endless and traceless cases overrun. Neglected, the infected had no one. See, much bigger battles had to first be won. And so its reign of terror raged, this fiery serpent from an ancient age, inflicting pain with disdain it waged, its war on the poor it played. It cared not for gender, age, or creed, at the water halls it poured its seed and sprung, its trap and when thirst ushered those in need, again the cycle of woe begun. It ravaged and bore through limbs and dreams, through the farmers' farms that yielded none, through the strained regimes, through poverty schemes, through the children's screams, even the soldiers' guns. Meanwhile, on shores a world away, the president's men pinned themselves afeat. To slay the serpent, come what may, so they built a team to complete the deed. The task seemed simple, make the waters clean, educate, engage, channel change through song, give the masses classes, no need for vaccines, just some local warriors with a will that's strong. And as the cause rang true, more joined the fray, donors to fund the fight, partners with roles to play, doctors to bring relief, leaders to lead the way. Experts with expertise, the tables turned that day. Together fight disease, together wage some peace, together inspire hope, together bring reprieve, together cure this ill, slay this parasite beast. Hand in hand, together we achieve. It's been 40 years, all of them toil bar none. A pipe dream at first facing 3,000,000 ones. Now it's just 13 cases, just 13. Thanks to warriors with filter pipes rebuilding dreams. Now it's just 13, I mean it's just 13. 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, none. It's just 13.
We're truly lucky that we get to work at a place that is doing this kind of work. And I think what always strikes me every time I see this is the vision that President Carter had to have early on to understand and recognize the link between conflict and service delivery, whether it's health or education or all of the other areas that lead to populations having productive, sustainable, healthy lives. And so anyway, like that always, touches me here. I have to say, it's like, it's just an amazing, video. But that's not all, right? That's not all that President Carter worked on. As I mentioned, he is incredibly, prolific in his work and just had incredible energy and has, worked on so many other parts of the world. So the next story I want to tell or share is about the work that we did in Haiti. Then the lesson I think we can learn from this example is that sustained engagement is often critical to building confidence toward peace and to providing those opportunities to engage. If you've developed those relationships, if you have those contacts and those connections, when those opportunities arise for negotiations, you're much stronger for that. So in 1987, President Carter, Prime Minister George Price of Belize, and Carter Center senior fellow Bob Pastor, whom some of you may know, flew to Haiti after a presidential candidate was assassinated. And this that threatened to undermine the entire democratic process. The trio averted a crisis at the time, but later that year, the military intervened and prevented the election. And then in July 1990, after a successful election monitoring experience in Nicaragua, Haiti's then president and opposition leaders invited President Carter and Pastor to monitor the elections in Haiti. But then in September 1991, the Haitian military overthrew President Aristide. In spite of these setbacks, the Carter Center continued to engage, working to assist the international community to restore constitutional government in Haiti. And in early September of 1994, Haitian General Rosalynn asked President Carter to try and mediate and avert a U.S. military invasion. President Clinton asked Carter to travel to Haiti with Senator Sam Nunn and General Colin Powell, former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The delegation finally reached an agreement by late afternoon on September 18th, but it was 5 hours past the noon deadline set for them by the Clinton administration. By then, U.S. troops were on their way to Haiti, upending the agreement. This impasse ultimately led to a meeting with Haitian President Emile Jeannessan. And soon after, Jeannessan and Cedra signed an agreement to step down and restore Aristide as president, avoiding bloodshed. As this example indicates, the Carter Center aims to build long-term relationships in difficult places so that we're primed and ready to contribute to building peace at key moments. And a final example of President Carter's early work is his 1999 effort to negotiate a peace deal between Sudan and Uganda. President al-Bashir of Sudan and Museveni of Uganda invited President Carter to facilitate discussions on improving bilateral relations between the two countries. This was a euphemism for addressing more than 15 years of armed conflict in which the various state and non-state actors were involved. The Carter Center's conflict resolution program worked for several months with high-level representatives of each government to define an agenda for the discussions. In the summer of 1999, President Carter mediated negotiations between al-Bashir and Museveni to end the conflict. President Carter was often willing to speak with leaders who were characterized as spoilers or bad actors. As in his presidency, he walked the line of bravely speaking truth to them while also welcoming them to the table. And in the end, Sudan and Uganda signed an 11-point document agreeing to renounce the use of force to resolve differences and to respect each other's sovereignty. The lessons, and there are many lessons, President Carter's early work taught us: seeking tangible results to improve people's lives, engaging over the long term in difficult places, and interacting with all parties inform the Carter Center's work today. Now I want to share four current programs that actually build on the work of President and Mrs. Carter in those early days, while also incorporating and addressing some new challenges that we're all facing. So, for example, we built on President Carter's legacy in Sudan by continuing to support efforts for peace and democratic processes. After the peace agreement was signed, we identified that youth who had brought about the agreement were still not being involved in the process. This was both wrong and likely to lead to another uprising and disillusionment. So we mapped out all 7,000 youth groups across the country and helped them to organize their own network, the Youth Citizen Observer Network. This network was finally established in the days leading up to the current conflict, but they have been collecting data and sharing observations on behalf of all youth in Sudan from the beginning. This information is shared publicly, and now that there is an institution representing all youth nationwide, they are able to ably be represented in civilian dialogues and provide that youth voice into the decisions being made for how to solve the crisis. So I told you the story of Guinea Worm and the Guinea Worm ceasefire in Sudan. I see echoes of that in our current Peace Through Health or Health Through Peace work in Mali. The Carter Center supports the Malian Ministry of Health in its fight to eliminate neglected tropical diseases such as guinea worm, but also trachoma. Since 2012, conflict has scarred northern and central Mali, and intercommunal violence and fighting between the various armed groups, some with links to terrorist organizations, has displaced tens of thousands. In this context, our guinea worm eradication program and trachoma control have been facing immense challenges in reaching communities where these diseases are endemic, much like those that we faced in Sudan many years ago. So to gain better access to these communities, the Center's Conflict Resolution and health staff have teamed up to promote a community-based approach to conflict mitigation and resilience building. The center staff convene health workers and local communities, community workers for dialogue on topics such as conflict resolution and gender inclusion, and they also work on developing or building health packages. These are like it's like a suite of goods and services for things like health clinics or wells or other things that will ultimately improve the lives of the communities. The communities then agree to observe a local truce while those packages are being delivered. So that in this way, the center, we're aiming to reduce violence while creating conditions that would allow for better access to health and disease elimination services in central Mali. And so far, we've seen some pretty impressive results. During our pilot project in 2021, health workers were able to investigate over 100 guinea worm rumors, while in 2020, they weren't able to investigate, partly due to security concerns. And in addition, we've seen a reduction in violence. Only one violent incident per month was reported by local health workers over the period of the initiative's activities, compared to over 10 per month previously, prior to this initiative. I personally love seeing how our staff and partners, without which we couldn't do any of this, of course, continue to honor President and Mrs. Carter's goals of both building peace and fighting disease. I want to shift gears a little bit. I've been talking about our international work. I want to talk a little bit about our work here at home in the United States. So I mentioned President Carter's principles of bringing all parties to the table to promote peace. As you well know, in the United States and in my home state of Georgia, we've seen increasing polarization and mistrust in our election system. And I wanted to share this quote that I was struck by President Carter on this very topic. He said, "I now fear that what we have fought so hard to achieve globally, the right to free, fair elections, unhindered by strongman politicians who seek nothing more than to grow their own power, has become dangerously fragile at home." So during the run-up to the 2020 elections, we started to have discussions in the Carter Center because we were all concerned about the polarization and what we were seeing. And out of that discussion, out of discussions with President Carter, we began a new stream of programming right here in the United States. Based on our decades of overseas experience and our analysis of the U.S. political situation, we knew part of what we needed to do was to bolster trust and transparency around our own elections. And we knew we needed to make it possible for leaders here in the United States to stand up for common norms of democracy and for nonviolence. To address this, we've taken an integrated approach to these challenges. We are engaging in a range of activities across the spectrum to increase understanding of how elections work and to advance a national conversation about election reform. And we're also building a network to combat the epidemic of mistrust through coalitions of cross-partisan leaders who collaborate to solve common challenges and advocate for a better democracy and against violence. Through these democracy resilience networks, we have been working to empower local influencers across the spectrum, across the political spectrum, who can promote norms around civility as well as democracy. These unwritten rules can make or break a system of government. Rules like that a candidate who loses an election should concede, that they should refrain from spreading misinformation, and that they shouldn't incite violence. So let me give you one example of the work of our resilience networks. The North Carolina network identified election processes as an area of common concern. They held trusted elections information education events, it's a mouthful, trusted elections information education events in all 14 of the state's congressional districts, and they collaborated with our election experts, the state, and Catawba College to launch a cross-partisan statewide commission on electoral reform that will jointly examine best practices in elections and produce a set of recommendations supported by all sides for the state to consider. So, and the one other thing I should mention about that is we are tailoring our approaches state by state to the needs. We are looking to local leaders. This is a lot of the lessons and the things we've done overseas, we are applying, right? We're able to apply right here at home to again, advance our own and support our own democracy. And with that, I would say our work building peace is never done, and we are always facing new challenges and opportunities like this one. To wrap up my talk, I'd like to share a little bit about some of the other seeds we are currently planting related to climate and information integrity specifically. This continued growth and innovation honors President Carter, who often quoted his beloved teacher, Miss Julia Coleman, who said, "We must adjust to changing times and still hold to unchanging principles." So first, as you all know, climate change is an existential crisis for our generation. We have been exploring how we can use our expertise and relationship to contribute to the fight against climate change. And one place we've been active in doing so is in the Democratic Republic of Congo. The DRC's natural resources are essential in the clean energy transition, but its citizens often do not reap the benefits. To give you one example, renewable energy systems require up to 12 times more copper than traditional energy systems, and the DRC is the world's third largest producer of copper. However, only 19% of DRC's population actually has access to electricity. So we're currently exploring how we can contribute to the just energy transition through our extractive industries governance project. And what does that do? So we work with civil society to strengthen partner capacity to monitor, analyze, and report on mining projects and sector-wide issues. And for example, we often take that a step further by encouraging the DRC government to require mining companies to use some of their profits to benefit mining companies. For example, our team has supported the negotiations of 12 local development agreements between mining companies and the communities in which they operate to help ensure that mining revenues contribute to sustainable development. And so for our last video, I want to share a little bit more about our work in the DRC.
D'abord, il est important de rappeler que la RDC fait partie des pays qui ont beaucoup de ressources minières. Vous avez d'un côté des ressources immenses et de l'autre côté la population pauvre. Et parmi les raisons qui expliquent ce fait que l'exploitation ne profite pas aux populations, c'est la gouvernance. Donc la manière dont les contrats sont signés, la manière dont les revenus sont gérés, tout ça, ça fait que la grande majorité, la part importante des revenus ne va pas dans les projets d'investissement, dans les projets pour l'intérêt des populations.
The Carter Center has been working since 2011 to help ensure that the people of the DRC benefit from their country's natural resources. In 2018, the center successfully advocated for mining code reforms, including a provision that requires companies to work with people living near mines to determine their community's biggest needs, and signed an agreement called a cahier de charge, promising to fund projects to help meet those needs.
Ça veut dire la loi prévoit que il y ait des comités locaux composés des communautés, des autorités locales pour suivre l'implémentation, l'exécution de ces projets qui sont dans le cahier des charges.
Et c'est là où le centre Carter a intervenu, c'est-à-dire et le centre Carter devait maintenant nous assister à l'élaboration d'abord.
Carter Center teams then helped establish processes and worked with residents to develop their negotiating skills.
Et avant d'arriver aux tables de négociation avec l'entreprise, on avait nécessairement besoin que les centres Carter puissent nous donner maintenant l'orientation comment on devait traduire le problème qu'on avait en projet.
Parce qu'à ta budget à Nyumba,
c'est comme ça que par une grâce qui est tombée sur nous, les centres Carter est venu pour nous former, nous renforcer en capacité afin de nous préparer à affronter les négociations du cahier des charges avec l'entreprise qui a déjà beaucoup d'experts en la matière.
Nous avons demandé la construction des structures de santé. Nous avons demandé les forages d'eau. Nous avons demandé aussi l'adduction en électricité, en énergie électrique. Nous avons demandé la construction des écoles.
Some of those projects are now well underway.
En tout cas, si nous sommes devenus ce que nous sommes aujourd'hui, c'est grâce au Centre Carter qui nous a beaucoup soutenus, qui nous a formés, renforcés en capacité.
Even some of the mining companies see the benefits.
I would like to say thank you to Centre Carter, and I hope this follow-up is not going to stop today, because before we used to do community projects, but it's also very good to have some other people to come and check what you are doing for the community. Maybe sometimes you think that you are doing enough, maybe you are wrong.
Carter Center staff have put together a handbook that communities all across the DRC can use to help them create their own cahier de charge with mining companies in their areas.
Les gens sont impatients parce que, comme je l'ai expliqué avant, pendant très longtemps, le secteur minier n'a pas suffisamment contribué au développement des populations. Avec ça, les gens espèrent et vraiment sont impatients de voir des projets être réalisés pour le développement des populations.
So Fabienne is one of our superstar staff out in DRC. And what I really like about this example is it's this really holistic, integrative approach to a development problem, right? We have to look at legislative reform, community engagement, training, capacity building, working with human rights organizations. And it really is, we're looking to Fabienne and his team to kind of guide us and also make this a tailored approach, because what might be needed in one part of the country may not be what's needed in another. So again, I love this project. It's been going on for a while, and now we're kind of, again, innovating for another time to kind of address changing needs on the ground. In addition to climate work, we're also stepping up our increasing our work around combating mis and disinformation. We know this is a challenge that societies around the world are facing. And as an institution, we're exploring new ways for us to strengthen information integrity. Our digital threats team has developed, for example, a media literacy course to help adults evaluate misinformation and stop its spread. So we're doing things like that. And of course, we can't do this work alone. So we're partnering with private sector, public sector, and organizations, both local and international, to come up with new and innovative ideas to address sort of challenges to information integrity. So I've talked for a while. I've talked about how President and Mrs. Carter's work around the world and here at home have planted many seeds for peace. And I know other speakers have shared and will share even more about their legacy. But in closing, I'd like to propose that perhaps President and Mrs. Carter's most important influence has been their steady, continued faith that peace is possible. And I want to share a quote from a colleague of mine, Karen Ryan, who said, "In my more than 30 years of working with former U.S. President Jimmy Carter, I've been most touched by his deep faith in people, his belief that, given the chance, everyone has the capacity for good. He's always been confident that even the most vulnerable and persecuted can rise above any challenge if they have adequate resources and support, and he built the Carter Center to help fill this need. He's approached the powerful, be they warlords or heads of state, with the presumption that an appeal to reason, communicated with respect, might bear fruit. I've sometimes heard him called naive. This is wrong. His beliefs and actions have always been well informed. It's with eyes wide open that he chooses optimism, possibility, and faith over cynicism and arrogance. President and Mrs. Carter's work for peace is a conscious choice. President Carter said in his Nobel Peace Prize lecture that the bonds of our common humanity is stronger than the divisiveness of our fears and prejudices. God gives us the capacity for choice. We can choose to alleviate suffering. We can choose to work together for peace. We can make these changes, and we must. President and Mrs. Carter's deep-rooted hope that peace is possible should inspire all of us to continue sowing our own small seeds of peace. Thank you so much for your time today. It's been a pleasure to be here. Thank you.